When I finished my PhD, I moved to Irvine, one of the campuses of the University of California, working it with Sherry Rowland, with my Professor Rowland. That's a group doing very basic science at that time. But as a postdoctoral student, that's how I joined his group, we decided to move into a new field for us, which was the chemistry of the atmosphere. And again, it was a question of originating just with curiosity. We knew that there were certain industrial compounds that were being released to the atmosphere. The type of chemicals that were being released were similar to those that we were studying from a very fundamental point of view, chemical properties and so on, how these reactions take place. But something new happened at that time that I had not done in my earlier studies, which is looking at the natural environment, looking at the way the world functions as a whole. With other words, we became interested in environmental issues. So it was a new field for me at that time. But it was this basic drive, the basic curiosity to find out how things work. In this case, not how it works, but what is the consequence of society releasing something to the environment that wasn't there before? Could it do any damage? Perhaps not, but we thought it was important to find out anyhow. So that's how we got started in that problem. And of course, eventually realized that there's not something we were expecting at the beginning, but we did realize that there were important consequences from this apparently harmless human activity of releasing these gases, which are non-toxic at all. But eventually they decompose and indeed can affect the ozone layer in very significant ways. So it's again, just that drive of understanding how things work. In this case, what are the consequences of certain activities of society that motivated us to solve these problems? In terms of this issue of these industrial gases affecting the environment, at the beginning, the road was certainly not easy because we were suggesting that society had to change, that industries had to do something different than they were doing at that time. And of course, initially, we did not meet with a good reception to these ideas from industry and even from the scientific community. Even though our ideas were well received within the small group of specialists in what we were doing, it was not necessarily well received with the scientific community at large. So we really had to continue doing as good a science as we could, and at the same time trying to really communicate our conviction that this was something important, something that had to lead to changes in the way society was functioning. It's a conscious decision that Sherry Rowland and I did, not just to communicate our findings to other scientists, but to actually try to do something about it. In some sense, that was taking a risk. Of course, with the science of the ozone layer and the effects of industrial chemicals was not nearly as well established at that time as it is now. We were just convinced that it was very important to find out. On the other hand, we were taking a risk in that it's not the normal role expected of scientists. Our peers were perhaps questioning whether we were just seeking publicity or not. But again, we thought it was not important enough just to preserve our image in the scientific community compared to what we really thought we had to do, which is to find out more about the problem and let the governments know more about it so that eventually some action could be taken, and that's indeed what happened. It's easy to exaggerate problems as well, so we had to be very cautious. We had to always preserve our integrity as scientists, even though we were advocates in terms of trying to get society to do something about it. We had to continue with honesty in terms of how to express these fears, for example, to the news media. It's easy to try to exaggerate the problems just to get more attention. So for me, it was very clear that the best way to deal with that was to do the best science that I was capable of doing. Furthermore, to try to distinguish clearly when I was talking as a scientist in contrast to talking just as a person with value judgments in terms of thinking that society should do something about it, but that's not necessarily a scientific issue, that's more a conviction issue. Shortly after we realized the potential implications of our findings in terms of environmental effects, we were not entirely sure that we were right. We just thought that it was sufficiently important that we had to find out more about it. So that's the nature of scientific discoveries. When you first get into a new problem, you're not sure what the outcome is going to be, so you're always taking risks. In this case, the risk was even larger because we were suggesting that our findings had to lead to some changes in industry, if you want. So that was a big risk, but we thought it was certainly necessary to take it. And again, it was just a conviction that the problem was serious that led us to continue doing good science. And of course, I should point out, it's very important that it's work that we did with the rest of the scientific community, a small group of scientists all working in this field. We eventually all worked together, this community really succeeded to do first-rate science and to establish very clearly that the problem indeed is a very serious one. It was indeed something that happened sort of suddenly, because we had realized that these compounds would actually reach the stratosphere, that they would decompose there, and in fact, I even knew without too much trouble that these compounds could actually affect ozone to some extent. But I remember clearly one day actually doing calculations, find out how much of these compounds reaches the stratosphere, and comparing that with some natural processes, that I realized that the problem was really potentially very serious. So it's in a sense a moment of discovery, but it was different from the earlier ones I had as a child, because I was also very worried. It was not also, in this case, a scientific discovery, but also a discovery about something that could damage the environment. So it all seemed to be bad news at that time. That's why it has been very rewarding much more recently, not just to have discovered that there was this potential danger, but also to have realized that society can actually do something about it. And so that's why I believe it's really a success story, very different from that day in which I got very worried, because now essentially the international agreements recognize the problem and call for completely stopping the production of these chemicals that can harm the environment. It was indeed just putting together all the information that we had and putting it in context and realizing that just the way one sets up a scientific hypothesis, a sequence of steps with these very serious consequences. And so it's really just a moment when you put all this information together and realize that you have something important in front of you. It really started asking the question, what happens to these compounds once released to the environment? Our starting point was that these compounds had been measured to be throughout the atmosphere, not just close to cities, but in the northern hemisphere, the southern hemisphere. That was just the starting point. These compounds are very stable. They are non-toxic. You can even breathe them. So the assumption was that there was no worry because of the presence of these relatively small amounts, parts per trillion amounts of these compounds in the global environment. So that's what that was just the starting point. The rest was just scientific research. We were asking the question, what happens to these compounds? We realized that they would eventually diffuse to the stratosphere because nothing else would destroy them. In the stratosphere they would be destroyed, but that was not the end of the question. We had to pursue it several steps more. So what? Then we had to follow what happens to the decomposition products from these compounds. And that's, of course, where the effects on ozone begin. And so it's really taking a complete, an overall picture of the problem that led us to our discoveries. Of course, we were not sure. It's that we realized that atmosphere is very complicated, and that we didn't know, certainly by far, everything that there is to know about it. On the other hand, pieces of evidence began to come in from measurements. Experiments were carried out, and we knew that these gases were indeed reaching the stratosphere, the CFCs. We know that the decomposition products were indeed there. What was very difficult to measure is actual effects on ozone, because the ozone amounts in the stratosphere fluctuate. On the other hand, we actually did not predict that ozone would be depleted specifically over Antarctica. We just made a very general prediction that these decomposition products could affect the ozone layer in general terms. So it actually came as a surprise that that this large effect was happening in this coldest place on Earth. On the other hand, with all the scientific research that had been carried out before the Antarctic ozone hole was found, it was just a matter of a few years for us and the rest of the scientific community to understand, with experiments in the laboratory as well as in the atmosphere, very clearly why is it that specifically Antarctica was a place where this hole appeared. And the reason, of course, is that it's very cold there, and clouds can actually form over Antarctica that do not form anywhere else in the stratosphere, that are sufficiently cold to promote a new type of chemistry that we then investigated in the laboratory. So, with other words, what happens is, even though our predictions were not very specific, we lay down, together with our colleagues, the foundation and the infrastructure to really understand on a very rapid time scale the nature of all these effects once they became clear. I remember in some scientific meetings, again, arguing about the uncertainties of the problem. And there was not that much disagreement in terms of the science itself with our industry colleagues. It was more in either in the public relations arena or else in terms of whether to advise society to do something about it or not. I remember very well my attitude at that time was that at the very least, industry should do some research on potential replacements for these compounds. At the same time, of course, we had to know more about the atmosphere, but we had to begin thinking about the possibility of regulating these chemicals. And that's, of course, what the industry was supposed to do at the beginning, because they wanted more scientific evidence. But eventually, we came together, and when the scientific evidence indeed was very clear, we started to work in a collaborative mode, and that's what made it possible to reach these international agreements, the Montreal Protocol and so on a very short time scale. Two aspects. One is that they were reached with collaboration among all these different groups. And the second aspect, of course, is that they are working, all the industrialized countries are actually following the Montreal Protocol. It's not perfect. There are some problems here and there. But overall, it's indeed the case that these compounds, the CFCs, are no longer being manufactured. And it's also the case, it's also for me an important aspect of precedent of this problem, that industry, society, is very inventive. They were able to come up with technological solutions so that, of course, we still have refrigeration, we still have spray cans, we have a plastic foam. All the important uses of these compounds are still with us. And yet, these technological solutions, we don't have to benefit from these uses with CFCs. One can do that with compounds that are less damaging to the environment. Well, it's certainly very rewarding to see that indeed the world has responded, and that the nations of the world are certainly doing something about this problem. And to me, it's a very important precedent. In this case, we had some very specific chemicals which were being made by a relatively small number of industries. So the problem could be solved. It was by no means easy. But to me, it's a very important precedent. I'm an optimist. So that shows to me that even for these much harder problems that we have, such as the use of energy worldwide, which is not going to be as easy to come up with agreements. But nevertheless, we know there's an example out there that worked. So that means that we can also work to the solution of these other very challenging problems. What I really think is that it was the effort of a whole scientific community. Perhaps we started thinking about this problem, but the way I see it is having worked with an excellent group of colleagues. They all did excellent work. We all together planned experiments, showed in very clear ways that with very good science that the effect is real, and eventually worked also not just in the scientific community, but with economists, environmental organizations, lawyers, and certainly with industry itself. So to me, that's what is very rewarding, to see that all these sectors of society, some of which we were fighting with to begin with, that we all came together, and it's indeed possible in this collaborative mode to come up with solutions to these problems. I was born in Mexico City. I was born and raised in that city. I went to school and to college in Mexico, eventually studying chemical engineering. But long before I went to college, I was already fascinated with science. I remember playing with chemistry toys and microscopes and so on. So since I was a child, I really became very interested in science and had as a goal to become a scientist and to pursue scientific research as a career. So eventually, when I finished college in Mexico, in order to become a researcher, I decided to go abroad. So first I spent a few years in Europe, and then eventually came to the United States, obtained a PhD at Berkeley in chemistry. And that was the way in which I could actually sort of achieve my goal of doing research for a living. Well, I remember as a very young child, just natural curiosity, I guess, just trying to find out how toys work, taking them apart and so on, and eventually doing the same thing with chemistry sets. So it was really before entering high school that I realized that chemistry and biology, at that time it was not very clear for me which of the two, but that it was something fascinating for me. I began to read biographies of famous scientists. I also liked mathematics at that time, so I realized that I could combine this sort of natural curiosity for see how nature functions with a creativity in terms of trying to quantify also the way nature works. And it was really for me just a natural development, I believe, just to keep this interest, this natural curiosity alive, which sometimes through the natural process of going to school, somehow or other it dies or so. But for me, it was an obsession and was able to continue with it. In order to really pursue research, if you want, in order to really find new things, you have to be very motivated, and I was. Just having had experiences with discoveries, even things that had been discovered previously, but finding out for myself for the first time how something works, is really, really an enormous driving force. So to me, it was well, really liking very much what I was doing. And eventually, I sort of saw an evolution also in this passion to do science, that at the same time, it could be something valuable for society. So there's no conflict in this. To me, it was marvelous just to realize that I could actually be doing the things I like and at the same time getting paid for it and earn a living that way. But even one step beyond, that this knowledge that one can acquire through research could actually benefit society. Of course, science itself is not good or bad. It can be misused, but developing the proper responsibility to society and so on, I could see ways in which one can actually use this knowledge to benefit people around me. Well, I had no problems in school. In school, I believe I was practically always the first in my class. So it was relatively easy for me. In fact, one of the problems is that it often was rather boring, and I found some of the routine classes uninteresting. And so early on, I did not have as a goal just to get good grades. And in fact, in college, I really took off and studied mostly on my own and not always went to class. But in fact, the point is that the important thing for me was to learn, to pursue knowledge and research. And that was what motivated me. Well, it was probably a series of biographies of scientists like Pasteur or even earlier ones, Leeuwenhoek, inventing the microscope, and Madame Curie. I forget how many others, but it was really just for me a fascination to learn about these great heroes. At that time, of course, were totally inaccessible, almost non-human to me. Was again very interesting too. There are really very many. Again, as a child, it was obviously those scientists which had lived in the past that had made such an important mark in science history. But later on, there are really many others, and I got to know some of them eventually. I remember as a student in Berkeley, for me, the thrill that it was to be able to meet so many Nobel Prizes. Perhaps the most important contact with scientists for me was my mentors. My mentor in my PhD studies, which was Professor Pimentel, was really a marvelous person that really helped me out and formed me as a scientist. Well, first, as I explained to them that doing research is indeed a fascinating activity, but clarifying that it's not always easy. It's sometimes frustrating. You carry out many experiments, not all of them work, and so you have to be patient. But in the end, it's extremely rewarding. And I also try to explain that this other aspect, that it can also be very rewarding when you realize that as a consequence of what you do in science, you can benefit other people. It's really a very important aspect of the work we do, which it, at the same time, is I see through teaching. When I have students that work with me and I see how the progress they make and so on, and I see how I affect their lives, that's a very important aspect of doing research. I had a number of very good teachers in high school, in fact, some mathematics teachers that perhaps allowed me the freedom to go beyond the normal routine of the class and to explore some more advanced areas. The same thing happened in college. I was able to sort of communicate with a few of my teachers and professors and go beyond the normal expectations. And then, as I mentioned before, Professor Pimentel, my mentor for my graduate studies, was really influential in terms of the influence that he had on me. When I was very young, after I became interested in the chemistry sets, I had an aunt who was a chemist, and she really helped me doing more sophisticated experiments. So we went well beyond the chemistry sets, and actually even first year in high school, I remember we did experiments that were really college level. So for me, that really opened up my eyes that in principle I could do these other things as well. I started doing those, but I really moved fast into experiments just to it had to do with an analytical chemistry, trying to find the chemical composition of all sorts of things around us. So there were some very systematic ways of doing that. Perhaps that's when I first realized how fascinating research can be, finding out, sometimes through hard work, what sort of chemicals are in various things that we use. And so that was an awakening for me. Perhaps the earliest experiences that I had that I can think of where I realized the beauty of science is playing with toy microscopes and discovering that I could let some water and lettuce rot, very bad smelling things, but the fascination of finding things moving there and then discovering all the paramecia and all the life that is you cannot perceive just with your naked eyes, but then going beyond that and actually trying to follow and see how these small living things reproduce, what they eat and so on. It was just fascinating for me. It was not accessible with your naked eyes. It's something that you had to do something about to learn. Well, for me, it was just a thrill. I just remember at that time thinking, this is the sort of thing I would like to do if I could. I did not come from a family of scientists. My father was a lawyer. My older brother was a lawyer. So for me, that was a world that I did not know about. And just to realize that there were people out there in the world that were doing this all the time as a profession was something that I couldn't believe in as a child. Well, they certainly supported very much my career. This, in spite of not having a scientific tradition, and furthermore, in Mexico again, in Latin America, perhaps the science tradition is not as well established as it might be in either Europe or the United States. So it's not as common for children to become interested in these topics. I managed somehow or other to have friends just like everybody else, but for these hobbies, for these activities, I was sort of on my own. It was not something I was sharing with other friends, but I certainly had the support from family and teachers and so on. Well, for me, moving from Europe to the United States was a very important step. I had gone through college in Mexico in an engineering field, but what I really wanted to do was scientific research. The reason I did that in Mexico is that I did like mathematics, physics, and for me that was the way to combine it, to combine my scientific curiosity with mathematics and with chemistry at that time. But later I realized I really had to switch to chemistry as a science, and so coming to the United States, doing a PhD in chemistry in Berkeley, it was at the beginning a difficult thing for me to do. I really had to sort of learn much of basic science that I had not learned earlier on. But I was able to do that with some hard work. I eventually saw that I could actually master all these subjects at very good grades, and indeed start doing new research. We started finding out new ways in which molecules function, new ways in which chemical reactions take place. And again, that was really the sort of thing I was looking forward to work with since I was a child. Perhaps as in it started in high school with these teachers that I mentioned a little while ago that allow me sort of the opportunity to go beyond the normal curriculum to pursue some more complicated problems. But it was really then in college, that's the nature of a PhD thesis, to try to find something new and then to find encouragement from your peers, and in this case, of course, from my PhD advisor, Professor Pimentel, really encouraging me to pursue this line of thinking, to try to find new things, look at the overall picture of how the world functions, and go to more and more important problems. I think it's very important to take advantage of the fact that the scientific community is truly international. It's very open. Certainly for environmental issues, this is the case, where the information is freely exchanged. And that's why it's important to communicate with the rest of the world. And that's why it's important perhaps for students at some stage to go to different universities. It's best perhaps if the excellent students are the ones that have opportunity to go abroad. And then of course, hope is that they would go back and benefit their own countries. But in the end, much of the science that we do, because if it's international, we do it as a large group. But there's another important aspect, that there are some local problems for which you need a local perspective. Mm-hmm. And you need this combination of having access to the best there is in science with the realization of what your local problems are, your local perspective. That's what one needs to solve a variety of problems. When I first went to Europe after finishing my college degree in chemical engineering, I went to Germany. And at that time, I was in transition between engineering and science. I was studying polymerization kinetics, something to do with plastics, not with the atmosphere. But I realized that it was going to be easier or better for me to come to the United States, because the graduate system was it's easier here to start again. And I felt I really had to become a scientist, to have the opportunity to take more courses, to take a little bit more time. It was really a definition time for me, again, a career of science. I spent some time in France before I came to the United States, mostly studying on my own. It was an important time for me, not so much because of the science. I had a wonderful group of friends, and we discussed all sorts of problems facing society, politics and what have you. Perhaps it's those years that form me in terms of social responsibility, if you want. So when it's important to have an overall view of the world as well. And then eventually, of course, getting a PhD in Berkeley was very time consuming. I had to work very hard. But at the same time, those were very interesting times. The student movement, of course, was very much alive at that time. People's Park in Berkeley was the big issue. So I could see around me all these changes that were going on in society. So this opportunity I had to live in many different places, I think, turned out to be important in terms of having a perspective of these big problems that society faces. I have now the notion that it's very important for the this communication, not just between scientists, but between many different sectors of society, that this globalization is very important. These problems that we have to be tackled, not just by one country or by one group of people, but they have to be tackled by everybody together. So this internationalization of science is an essential aspect of the field. Well, I remember, of course, I had great difficulties when I first went to Germany. German is a difficult language, and just knowing Spanish was not particularly helpful. So I actually spent quite a bit of time with the language, and eventually became very proud of being able to participate even in discussions about politics with my German friends. Then eventually I spent some time in France. French was a lot easier. In fact, I remember also in Germany that the first language I learned was Italian, because it was so much easier for me, and I had some Italian friends, although I forgot most of it now. So by the time I came to the United States, I knew English only from high school and from textbooks, but I certainly couldn't speak it. But I didn't devote nearly as much energy learning English as I did learning German. I guess I was lazy after that much time with the other languages. But it was so much easier, I guess. So I still regret not having spent more time when first becoming a graduate student in the United States with the language itself. But it was so time-consuming to keep up with the science that I just picked up whatever came in terms of the language. What has happened is that English has become, as a matter of fact, the international language of science. So it's really essential for scientists all over the world to master English as a language. It used to be the case, perhaps earlier in the century, that German or French were the languages that one had to know about. And but that certainly has changed, and even language examinations here in the United States are no longer required to obtain a PhD. In some sense, I believe something is being lost here in the US by not learning other languages, because one really needs to know how other cultures function, and the language is an important part of that. But certainly to scientists abroad, a very important piece of advice is to learn not just to read English, but to actually communicate very well, because that's essential for this internationalization of science that we were talking about before. Perhaps as in it started in high school with these teachers that I mentioned a little while ago, that allow me sort of the opportunity to go beyond the normal curriculum to pursue some more complicated problems. But it was really then in college, that's the nature of a PhD thesis, to try to find something new and then to find encouragement from your peers, and in this case, of course, from my PhD advisor, Professor Pimentel, really encouraging me to pursue this line of thinking, to try to find new things, look at the overall picture of how the world functions, and go to more and more important problems. Well, my motivation was not really to, I could say, sort of get prizes or so, but it was the nature of the work itself. I was always motivated to discover new things. And at some stage, again, combine them with things that affect society. So it's this combination that was important for me. But perhaps it was natural then that if indeed the discoveries were important, if the impacts to society were important, that that would be an additional dimension I did not really consider explicitly at the beginning. One of the important aspects of scientific research is this attitude of learning continuously. In fact, the problem that we tackled that has to do with the way chemicals function in the environment is very interdisciplinary. So an important aspect of solving these problems is to be ready to learn new fields. We had to learn how the atmosphere functions. So it's a continuous learning, but continuous questioning also. And so that's where the, of course, previous preparation that I had was very important. Of course, one needs a very solid preparation in some, in my case, it was fundamental chemistry, but I had to learn many other things along the way. What we did initially, of course, is to communicate with other scientists to, like it's normally done, to find out whether we were making some big mistake or not. And actually, our ideas were very well received in this small community that were experts in this field. It was more in terms of the implications of these findings that we had problems. And it was very clear that what we had to do is to continue learning more about these hypotheses that we had initially come up with. After all, we did not have much information in terms of actual measurements in the atmosphere to begin with. So what we saw as an important aspect of the our role at that time was to make sure that the scientific community, as well as the government, would take the problem seriously enough to put enough resources to find out more about the problem. And we succeeded with this effort, again, with the help of many other colleagues, so that eventually many experiments could be carried out to either verify or disprove this hypothesis that we were thinking of initially. I think it is very important for to realize that the consequences of the activities of, on the one hand, of myself as a scientist doing research, how it can be used, but on the other hand, the consequences of all the way that society is evolving. I think we have some very challenging problems ahead of us. Population is growing at a tremendous rate. Developing countries are, of course, developing, and they certainly need to achieve a better standards of living. But that means that we're going to face some very serious problems, particularly next century, as all these activities begin to have even more and more effects on the environment. So for me, it's a very important drive to try to do something to make sure that society moves in the right direction, to make sure that our kids, future generations, have the same options that we have now. It's just something that I'm convinced needs to be done. Mm-hmm. On a global basis, of course, what happens is I'm worried about two types of problems that we have. One is in terms of effects on the environment. One is very easy to see: pollution in cities. For example, there are many large cities now all over the world that are highly polluted, and you just have to visit the cities and see what the problems are. What's happening is, if you take that pollution together with pollution coming from a burning of forests, for example, it's beginning to be on such a large scale that it is becoming a global problem, and it's only going to get worse again developing countries continue with their economic growth. And then we have a second set of problems, like the one that dealing with the ozone layer that I was involved with, that are not as visible, it's not as obvious that they are happening. And that had to do with consequences on the global environment, effects that can occur far away from the places where the emissions occur. But if you take a combination of these two, that just means that society has to move in new directions, again, to make sure that we can facilitate progress everywhere in the world, but not in the same way that it has happened in the past. Developing countries cannot develop in the same way that the industrialized nations of the West have done it, because there's just no room for that much pollution in our planet, which after all is not that large considering how many people are coming on board. When I was a child, nobody really worried about pollution in Mexico in general. It's something that I remember thinking it's not something Mexico has a luxury to worry about. There were other more important worries. And what's really happened is that pollution in Mexico City, for example, is so notorious, it's so bad that it is very much a local worry. It is not a matter of not having the luxury to do that, but it's essential to worry about it to prevent damage and to the health of very many people. So there has been a very large change in attitude, certainly in Mexico and in many other developing countries, that it's not a luxury to worry about this, but it's very important, because otherwise it costs a lot more to repair the damage. If you anticipate all these problems that can happen, you can achieve a higher quality of life, higher standards of living at a much lower cost. And of course, we have the example of the former Soviet Union and the Eastern countries, where again, for them, the environmental effects were very low priority. And of course, we've seen the enormous damage that many cities and many places have, and how terribly expensive is it to repair it now. So the message is that it's not a luxury. It's really essential to incorporate the environment as an integral part of the economy, as an integral part of what we regard as a quality of life. As a child, it was not something that when I was living in Mexico that I noticed very strongly. It was more something that evolved when I was finishing, in fact, my PhD, and then looking back, looking at what was happening in the world, that I realized I could actually combine this passion that I had to do scientific research, to do pure science, as we called it at that time. Now, of course, I call it fundamental science. It need not be pure in that sense. It could be applied. It could do some benefit for society. So it's quite possible to do first-rate science, at the same time, very applied in terms of solving actual problems, problems that society needs to get solved. So that's, again, an important conclusion that I arrived much later. I didn't have that vision when I was a very young student. This possibility of combining scientific research, finding solutions to problems, at the same time doing some benefit for society. Early on, I simply had the vision that finding out new things, finding out how nature works, discovering new aspects of knowledge that had not previously thought of, that was important. And I still think that indirectly that can only benefit society and mankind, particularly if it is not misused. Science itself need not be good or bad, but if it's properly used, we simply have more options to solve these difficult problems. Okay. But again, initially, I did not make that close connection between discoveries and benefit to society. Again, the change was to realize that there are so many important problems that we have that it is essential to really try to solve them head on, to try to use some of our best minds to anticipate some even more serious problems that we might have next century to ease the road for future generations. Well, I certainly want to continue trying to understand how the global environment functions. The Earth as a system is a very complicated one, and it needs to understand it, we need very many disciplines, very many different scientists working together. And I want to continue working with my specialty, which is chemistry, with the atmosphere. There's still much to learn about chemical reactions that occur out there in the air, in the atmosphere. So one of my projects now is to really learn more about this pollution that occurs in cities and that is spreading more to the globe. To learn it in enough detail so that we can better tackle it, that we can better come up with new ways of using energy, for example, that are not so damaging to the environment. Perseverance is part of it. Much of it is perhaps luck. I was lucky to be able to pursue this passion that I had to do scientific research and to have some very good colleagues, very good mentors. And that's why I also have a passion for education, to work with students, with my students and others as well, and to try to make it possible for them to also have some great findings that will benefit us all. One of the frustrating aspects of being a scientist is that you want to learn more and more. There's just no time, unfortunately. We can't do it all. But I wish I could really continue learning how the world functions. That's why perhaps I try to do it through my students. Try to get an overall feel for the big system. But it's a very complicated one. So that's why it's essential that we collaborate among scientists and also with the people outside the scientific world, of course. Perhaps one way is really just by example. We do research together. We find out some aspects of nature, some aspects of chemistry that are unknown or that are new. And it's perhaps through example, by actually doing research, that I can best communicate this. And of course, lecturing, I also try to communicate the importance of these problems. In the end, of course, we have to keep in mind that it's very important to do very high caliber science and to preserve also our integrity as scientists, honesty, and all these qualities that we like to communicate to students. So there's no single simple recipe, but perhaps just by example is one of the best ways to do it. I think you need to have a commitment and a passion to do whatever you're doing as an activity that really consumes you. It has to be something important, something also that you enjoy so that you can keep doing it. And something, again, as I see that you can see transcends just your own small world, perhaps, but that can have repercussions for other people that surround you as well. But it's a true commitment to, in my case, scientific research, finding out new things and hoping that they will benefit other people as well. I think the greatest challenge will be to maintain the world population that is growing in such a way that they will continue developing without damaging the environment to such an extent that the quality of life will be degraded. So the greatest challenge is to somehow or other be able to keep a stable world population, increasing the standard of living of so many people, but again, in ways that are different from what we have done in the past. That will take a lot of creativity and a lot of work from many groups to be able to achieve. The advice that I would give is, again, try to find something that you like. Try to devote really your energies to being very good at it. Try to achieve excellence. Don't necessarily have as a goal success or getting prizes or whatever, but just doing very good work. And work hard. Keep working at it. Be patient. Realize that it's not always, you don't always see the benefits of what you're doing short term. But in the end, in the activities that I do, for example, scientific research, can be extremely rewarding. It's really a very fascinating career. What the American dream means to me is that it's really a world of opportunities. I came to the United States, of course, as a foreign student, but really had the same opportunities as any other student who was born here or not. And had the opportunities to access whatever was available in the system and to participate in the functioning of the society here. For example, at the moment, I'm a member of a PCAS, which is a Presidential Committee of Advisors of Science and Technology. So it's a group of people from the scientific world and from industry, and we advised the administration as to science policy and so on, and technology and so on. So it's something that I can do even though I was born in Mexico as a foreigner to begin with, but of course very much so now as part of the American dream, if you want, of actively participating in the way the society functions in this country. So it's really just a marvelous opportunity, just this really openness that the opportunity is out there. You just have to work hard. And of course, part of it is luck also. You have to have some luck to be able to achieve, but you at least you know that it's open to everybody. As a young child, I remember just dreaming about the Nobel Prize, but that was just a dream. It's not something I would have ever thought was possible for me. So achievement to me is something that just comes with this attitude of doing your work the best you can in a passionate way. And it's not something that you have to expect. It's something that is a consequence of what you do. But it's certainly important. We talked about perseverance, hard work, motivation, and the realization again that it's that you're working together with other people, not just yourself, but it is the collection of efforts from groups of people that makes all this possible. I remember just going to work in my laboratory at MIT and receiving a call from Sweden. I didn't know what it was about. And so when they told me about the Nobel Prize, I guess my first reaction was disbelief. I was not prepared for that. But I have a good colleague in the Royal Academy of Sciences in Sweden who also was on the phone and talked to me. So I realized it was for real. And of course, I was very happy for me and my colleagues and for the fact that the Nobel Prize could be given also in the environmental sciences. Of course, we were showing that one could do first-rate science and at the same time in a new field that had not been singled out for Nobel Prizes in the past. So it was, of course, just a wonderful day of celebration with my students and with other colleagues. And in Sweden, it's an incredible experience. It's for over a week of partly celebration, partly participating in discussions, round tables, and very formal dinners, but also parties with students. So it is really an extraordinary event, almost like a fairy tale. Well, I see that, of course, the award, that's an incredible honor, also some responsibility. I see that I have to really motivate particularly young people to strive to do very good work, and to motivate, on the one hand, people in the environmental sciences also, that one can do very good science there. Furthermore, motivate people in my country of origin, Mexico, and also in Latin America, that everything is possible. You can do very good science and achieve the highest levels. It doesn't matter where you come from. So it is a new responsibility that I feel of just trying to communicate all these important aspects of being a scientist. I went back, in fact, on my way from Stockholm before coming to the United States. I spent a few days in Mexico. And just a few weeks ago, I went back once more to Mexico to initiate the scholarship program, which is targeted to students from Latin America to do research, particularly in the United States, so that they could come and then go back. And it was really initiated partly with some of the Nobel Prize money that I received, but I was very pleased to also see a large increment to this seed money from the Mexican government as well as from Mexican industry. So they are very eager to help and to get these sort of programs started, because there are very few scientists in developing countries that can tackle these very large problems that we were talking about before. So I think it's important to facilitate the formation of even more of them. And so these type of programs are, I see, as potentially very important ones. I think it is very important that we have cooperation. Mexico and the United States, of course, sharing a border, it's very important, obviously, for problems at the border, but it's also important for global problems. It's important, not just with Mexico in this case, but with the rest of Latin America, to have this cooperation, to begin to think about these very big problems that we have. And again, I see as a good sign this interest that young people have. In fact, I see these environmental issues as a type of issues that for young people all around the world are united. It's something that unifies them, and that they see that it's going to be very important to take care of the planet, and for that they all have to work together. And that's why I'm an optimist that in spite of the magnitude of these problems that we have, that there's some hope that the new generations will try to solve these problems even more vigorously than we have in our own generations. There are so many books that that I would like to think of, so that I would be hard pressed to select just one. But perhaps I would just do what motivated me as a child, to read them some biographies of a great scientist, to try to communicate this enthusiasm of trying to find out new things, trying to find out ways that you can actually do some good things for people around you. The advice I would give is again, first of all, to find a field that you like. If you are good at mathematics and physics, then you can move in that direction, physical chemistry, for example. But it's important to have a very good foundation if you want to do scientific research in one of the basic sciences. But at the same time, the advice that I would give is that in parallel to that very basic foundation, to also learn about some other aspects of science and aspects about the way society functions, humanities, and so on. With other words, to try to get a broad liberal education while at the same time a solid foundation, in my case, in one of the sciences. And I understand that's, of course, a challenge. But it's important not just to do science and only science. It's also important not to try to learn about everything and then not be good at any one particular aspect of knowledge. One has to achieve the right balance between these two goals. Well, the general advice is really to try to keep working hard, to care about your communities, care about the world, and care about other people's, how everybody lives, and to try to give everybody the opportunity to achieve higher qualities of life.